everybody knows. And Mr. Sudhakar Reddy himself must have written at least 20 to 30 times how this smuggling is going on, how the law is not being implemented. And everybody in Tirupati and other surrounding areas, Rayalaseema, Karnataka and Tamil Nadu, they know what is happening. And everybody know the route that's from Seshachalam directly to Chennai and from there to China or Japan. The routes are very clear. Then why are they not doing? Yeah, the law is there. The Forest Act was amended in 2016. And they know now the law is, if you arrest somebody and accuse him of smuggling, he has to prove that he is not a smuggler. No, so law is totally different. There is no difficulty on Forest Department or Prosecution Department to say that this fellow has smuggled. So it is damn clear. Then still why are we not in a position to do it? And drone technology, some people are asking for drone technology to find out. In my view, everybody knows who is doing it. After reading Sudhakar Reddy's book, my conclusion is everybody knows what is happening and who is doing it, how it is happening, modus operandi, everything they know. If an ordinary journalist, of course, with a great interest in investigation, Sudhakar Reddy knows it, why not a department meant for it? Why not a team constituted for it? Why not a government which knows it, which makes law, know it? So everybody knows. What is lacking is one aspect, which is already dealt by my co-panelists. But I would like to say corruption is the serious factor. The connection and corruption, the unholy links between the persons who are supposed to curb it and persons who are doing it. So this is the stumbling block. Your law, your technology, your wonderful people, your great officers who fought, who entered into encounters, took risks, killed people, got injured, but still this is not going to stop.
Unfortunately, it's probably what Raghuveer Garu has mentioned. The fact that you're not backing up the forces enough. One is corruption at one end, but Avi, like you mentioned, we have had people who have actually put up their life and limb there and lost, but they have not become national heroes. We are not celebrating them like the way we are celebrating people on the borders. Is that what is, because there have been officers, men on the ground who have been exemplary in the way they have worked. I mean, they've gone, should I say, beyond their call of duty, what a normal human would do. They're able to do that. And yet, we are not able to capitalize on that kind of an inspiration. Is it because he says everybody knows about it, but the public consciousness, is it not been there? I mean, maybe a book like Sudhakar's will now say, oh my God, you know, people know Sandalwood, they know a Veerappan, but they don't know a Red Sanders. You think everybody knows because you're saying
everybody knows.
I know. But is that what it is? I mean, we are not able to put up a force that is inspired enough or given enough backing in terms of resources. Is that what it is?
Yeah, basically, you need to understand when you are actually fighting a war, you need to actually equip yourself for that. You can't really have a person wielding a lathi then covering 3,000 hectares of area all by himself and expect that fellow to prevent felling of the trees. It needs to be substantially strengthened. I think that's where we are not really getting that much of support in terms of either reduction in the area of the beat, which can actually solve the problem. Actually, I always say if there's a problem, you just look the other side of the problem, you'll find the solution. If you say our people are not able to go vast areas and protect them, then reduce it. Or if one person is not able to do it, increase the number. I mean, as simple as that. I think India has got 130 crore people. I mean, people are unemployed. Why don't you create? I mean, that's where you can create a lot of things. I mean, have a base camp for every 100 hectares if you want. Today we have a technology to tell where exactly the prime Red Sanders trees are there. Trees with the potential girth of 60-70 centimeters, which the smugglers actually selectively fell. I mean, you identify those compartments and make them like a line of control, and then like what we do in the borders, protect religiously. Why can't we do that? That's where I think that's where the people also, the local people there, also need to hesitate about it and then say this is our property. Actually, if you see our national forest policy 1988, it says forest is not the lookout of forest department alone. It's a national asset. Every Indian should be proud of it and protect it and conserve it.
In the era of climate change, we realize that it's everyone's...
And people, unless that sort of a concern comes from the vast majority, I think if 130 crore people raise a voice and say we want forest to be protected, then jolly well everyone will protect. There's absolutely no issue. It's not that some animal is coming and cutting the tree. It is only people like you and me who is coming. So it's not that difficult to control it, provided we have the public hesitating about it and then providing enough probably strength to the force. And that's where I think probably a few steps have been taken after we have done a study and gave recommendations. They said interdepartmental coordination, the police force also has joined, a special task force was set up, and then at least there was a fear of law coming in at that particular point of time. The locals have stopped felling the trees, and it's only the outsiders, people from other states coming in and felling. I think that has started. But I'm sure Krishna Rao garu will also say, when you want to tackle antisocial element, no, there is a strategy. So that strategic plan has to be prepared not by one department but by the government in the consultation with all the stakeholders. Then you go and pump all the money. I mean, how much money it needs? Maybe if it needs 500 crores, give it. 1,000 crores, give it. What is preventing you? I mean, we spend so much of money just doling out.
The Chief Justice made a mention about involving locals, but forestry programs have involved locals to protect forests, isn't it? Making the partners and stakeholders, they are obviously the stakeholders in this.
Yeah, definitely. People who are in the forest fringe villages, definitely they have a big stake. But in this Red Sanders area, you will find vast areas are without any village. I mean, the nearest village will be probably about 10, 15, 20 kilometers away. It's all terrain is also very difficult. I think Sudhakar knows it. He did one trek there, but Seshasalam Hills, it's inhabitable. And that's where we need to see how best we can strengthen our force there and identify the compartments where the fellings are happening. Unfortunately, today, we don't have an exact record of the number of fellings that have happened. I think that's a starter. See, if you have a problem, you go to doctor, you tell the doctor what is your problem, stomachache, headache, brain, whatever. Then only medicine can be given. So you're not telling which compartment I'm having fillings. Today we talked about rough estimate is last 15 years, 60 lakh trees have been gone. So where are those 60 lakh trees? Which compartment? There's no record. If you check the forest department record, you'll find, because again, that's a question of accountability. See, the moment you report some fillings, you are either charge sheeted or amount is thought to be recovered from you. So there is a disincentive for reporting. That's what is the issue.
You mentioned about lack of political will. Is that what it reflects that, Raghuveer garu spoke about the difficult terrain. Whether, on the borders, it's always been difficult terrain for us. But the government has not left it to, saying that nature will take care of it or the law of the forces. Does that once again indicate to you that it is a political will that is lacking, and how are we going to tackle it? I mean, Sandalwood, Veerappan, everybody knew about it. It was a topic all of us spoke about, and he was this dreaded guy and so on and so forth. But Red Sanders has not been able to occupy that mind space as much as a Sandalwood.
Actually, there are two ways of looking at this problem. First is the prevention. If you have adequate manpower, and as he said correctly, the number of trees is not large. You can increase the people who are monitoring and keeping surveillance and ensure that nobody will be able to have access and chop it off. That's a prevention. A far more important thing is the guy who is financing, and somehow we have to prove in a court of law beyond reasonable doubt that the person who is benefiting from all this, the person who is exporting it to China or Japan, and who is employing these woodcutters and financing it, is X. Once that is done, you will get a very deterrent sentence. One of the advantages to this, the guy who is actually financing, is the Constitution of India, Schedule 7, it mentions what are the items in the state list and what are the items in the union list and what are the items in the concurrent list. Though forest was originally in the state list by an act of God or Indira Gandhi, in 1966 it was shifted from the state list to concurrent list, which means that both the states concerned as well as the government of India do have a role in ensuring that this threatened species does not disappear. However, each state is an independent entity. India is a union of states, And unfortunately, this takes place in a trijunction of three states. The people who perpetrate the crime are from Tamil Nadu, out of utter poverty. People who finance it are also from Tamil Nadu. But the victim is largely the forests of Seshachalam, which are in Andhra Pradesh. Finally, it leaving the shores of India is again through one of the three ports, Chennai or Ennore or Thoothukudi. One of those ports it goes. So there is the most important agency whose job it is to check what is leaving the shores, the customs and central excise, who are not one bit bothered. And in any case, they say they are overworked. Thousands of 20-foot containers sealed leave the shores of India, especially on the east coast, whether it is Chennai or Ennore itself is a containerized port. It's not an ordinary bulk cargo port. It's all, everything is containerized. So if you suspect one particular container out of those 20,000 which are there to likely to have some small portion of red sanders mixed with something else, then you break it open and you realize that you become a fool. The information that you got is wrong. So we need a multidisciplinary team well-versed in investigation and gathering of evidence, which includes not merely police officers or the forest officers, but also the customs and central excise. Since this is not really an act of terrorism, NIA is not interested. But if only we have some kind of an agency for the biodiversity, protecting biodiversity, eventually the world will have to pay a very heavy price. So something like that, which is capable of having jurisdiction in all the three states and is well-versed in adducing evidence in a court of law linking the actual kingpin and the financier to the crime of felling. So that is required, but that requires a lot of strategy, that requires a lot of funding, that requires a lot of attention. And to start with, certainly the manpower available in that Seshachalam, at least to tackle the preventive aspect.
Sudhakar has in fact mentioned in his book about how containers would be, you know, will contain very, very innocuous substance. And then subsequently, the seal is also not removed. Your seal will be intact. And yet inside, the material has changed. You have also made a reference to the political involvement in it. Is that really one of the key aspects again? Because we have so far not found, at the highest levels, we are not saying leadership is involved. It can be, you know, local leaders who may be financing some local politicians. So that would show that the larger political system is not, you're not alleging corruption there.
Yes. In one of the chapters, I mentioned about the political nexus, which speaks about how the local operatives, including Kollam Gangireddy and others like Mahesh Naidu, are affiliated to either of the parties, which are at that point of time or this point of time. So, but at the highest level, though one of the researchers, French researcher called David Picheret, he made very startling claims, which I didn't buy it because, of course, there could be something suspicious, but finding evidence regarding that is very difficult. But one aspect
you
is
the journalist, yeah. you did not go with anything that you could, yes, not establish.
Yes, but one thing is sure. I was during recent Tamil Nadu elections. There was a spur of red sanders felling, and the district SP himself on record told that it's aiding elections there, and likewise in Rayalaseema in certain constituencies, wherever there are elections or whenever the funding goes from the operatives of international level or national level. So obviously there is an excess, but up to what level, that has to be probed further. And as you are talking about political will, in one of the chapters in the book called Dawood, Sahul Hamid and His Men, I have spoken extensively about how when Chandrababu Naidu was the first chief minister of residual Andhra Pradesh state, with the political will, they were able to get Gangireddy deported from Mauritius. When even Prime Minister Modi, one of the references I mentioned is how Prime Minister Modi got intervened. Sushma Swaraj spoke to the High Commissioner there and all those things, and got Dangareddy out of. So why not we are not able to get Sahul Hamid, who is hiding in Dubai, and still a red corner notice is pending against him. There would be a lot of, his network is huge, and there are a lot of such guys operating within and outside the country. So if there is a political will, like what happened in Gangareddy case or other cases, but I think Professor Garu can tell, because extradition is a very difficult aspect. Maybe he can throw some more light on that, because what I feel, there are aspects like dual criminality, and even UAE is not willing to arrest him and do that.
No offense on their land.
No. So, I'd like to say one thing. All the issues that we have discussed now in the second spell of our discussion relate to governance. These are all not systems issues. These are all governance issues. Now, looking at system, international system, Sudhakar was pointing out, that happens only when a kingpin is supposed to be extradited to our country. That remains there. Okay, we are successful in Gangareddy's case, but we are trying perhaps for in other cases. But my point is, you know the exit points. You know where it is happening. I come back to that question. There is one innocuous, very interesting sentence that is available in Sudhakar's book. That is, what is this? Telugulo cheptanu. పట్టుబడిన రెండు ట్రక్కులకి బదులుగా 8 ట్రక్కులు బయటకు వెళ్ళిపోతున్నాయి. అంటే ఏమిటి? 2 ట్రక్కులు మీరు పట్టుకోండి, 8 ట్రక్కులు మేము పంపించుకుంటామనే ఒప్పందం ఉందని అందులో ఒక వాక్యం ఉంది. దిస్ ఈస్ బఫలింగ్ ఇన్ఫర్మేషన్ ఫర్ మీ. నేను భయపడుతున్నాను ఈ ఇన్ఫర్మేషన్ ఇట్లా ఉంటే. అంటే వీళ్ళు పట్టుకునేవి కూడా ఆ కోట వాడు నిర్ణయిస్తాడనమాట, స్మగ్గులు చేసేవాడు. ఎంత దూరంగా ఉండేది ఇది? మనం ఇప్పుడు పొలిటికల్ వీళ్ళంటే